Today on NewsWatch, Republican presidential hopefuls go toe-to-toe in Wisconsin. CBN's political correspondent brings us a preview of the debate. Plus, Israel's prime minister is in the United States. We'll break down what's on his agenda and how he and the president are working to mend fences.
It's impossible to believe that your son could get in trouble because somebody forwarded a video to his phone that he has no control over receiving it.
Parents, this is a story you won't want to miss. We'll show you how police are cracking down on teen sexting. Thanks for joining us for CBN NewsWatch. I'm Ephraim Graham. Republican presidential candidates face off in Milwaukee. It is their first debate since the highly criticized CNBC meeting. This time around, the primetime lineup is down to eight. CBN's David Brody brings us the story.
This presidential race has turned into a regular soap opera. Since the last episode just 2 weeks ago, plenty has changed. Co-frontrunner Donald Trump took a turn as SNL host.
The president of Mexico is here to see you.
Oh, that's great. Send him in. Ah!
Donald!
Enrique!
I brought you the check for the wall.
Ben Carson has been taking on the media for what he calls unfair treatment of his past during the vetting process. The good doctor gave CBN News his take on the circus.
You know, this sort of like, you take a can of Raid and you spray a fly and they fall down, they start spinning on their back. That's the way they are right now. And, you know, they're looking for, they're desperate. Clinging to anything. What did he say? Oh, we can get him on that. And of course, nothing's working because none of it has any substance.
Jeb Bush hopes to show that he's the candidate with the substance. He has his new Jeb Can Fix It bus tour.
What's good on you?
Live free or die?
Jeb Bush is in the Granite State, a three-day bus tour.
The main stage will also look less crowded. Mike Huckabee and Chris Christie did not register high enough in the polls, so they'll be on the undercard debate. This despite a Christie video that went viral, showing his talk about the need to treat drug addiction. He plans to bring that subject up tonight, and it's something he discussed with me during this campaign.
No matter what state I go to, David, I meet parents, spouses who come up to me in tears talking about the loved one that they lost to a heroin addiction, cocaine addiction. It is an epidemic in our country.
The last Republican debate was on CNBC, and many critics panned it because it was over the top when it came to a liberal flavor. Now it's on the Fox Business Network. So Republican candidates are hoping they'll have some sort of different treatment there. Matter of fact, the moderators have said that they will keep all of the questions to strictly economic issues. David Brody, CBN News, Washington.
The Islamic State has released 37 Syrian Christian hostages. Most of them are women. Activists with the Assyrian Human Rights Network say ISIS freed the Christians over the weekend. They were among more than 200 Assyrian people abducted by ISIS in February. Islamic State jihadists shot and killed three Assyrians in October. And negotiations continue for the release of another 124 people who remain in captivity. Israeli Energy and Infrastructure Minister Yuval Steinitz is warning of a massive Iranian military buildup through Russia and other countries. He raised Israeli concerns Russia will deliver to Iran the S-300 missile defense system, the most sophisticated of its kind in the world. Steinitz also warned of the growing Iranian influence inside Syria.
If Syria will become an extension of Iran, this means, at the end of the day, that we shall see a direct, strong and permanent Iranian naval presence in the Mediterranean, in the ports of Latakia and Tartus. This is dangerous to Israel, to the region, and I believe also to Europe and NATO.
Steinitz's comments come one day after Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu met with U.S. President Barack Obama in the White House. This week, the president and Prime Minister Netanyahu worked to mend some badly damaged fences. Our Jennifer Wishon has more now from the White House.
With a handshake, President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu put their solidarity on display for Israel's enemies. The two men have always held vastly different worldviews, but their relationship has been particularly sour since the president feverishly pushed for a nuclear deal with Iran that the prime minister and others across the political spectrum in Israel adamantly opposed.
It's no secret that the prime minister and I have had a strong disagreement on this narrow issue, but we don't have a disagreement on the need to making sure that Iran does not get a nuclear weapon, and we don't have a disagreement about the importance of us blunting destabilizing activities that Iran may be taking place. And so we're going to be looking to make sure that we find common ground there.
The president tried to make it clear that he stands with Israel, but the Israeli people may not buy it. On the streets of Israel, many Israelis refer to the president by his middle name, Hussein, a reference to his Muslim heritage. Polling shows just 9% of Israelis believe this White House is pro-Israel. The president condemned recent Palestinian violence against innocent Israeli citizens. And while peace talks are on ice, Netanyahu says he remains committed to a peaceful two-state solution with the Palestinians.
I don't think that anyone should doubt Israel's determination to defend itself against terror and destruction. But neither should anyone doubt Israel's willingness to make peace with any of its neighbors that genuinely want to achieve peace with it.
International analysts say it's important for Israel's enemies to see the U.S. and Israel stand together.
There is a symbolic component that those enemies need to understand that there isn't any daylight between the United States and Israel as far as our alliance and our friendship. And that message has to be put out there very strongly.
While in Washington, Netanyahu is speaking to both conservative and progressive groups to make the case that the security of Israel isn't a partisan issue.
Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. It's the most Western-looking country for a lot of miles in that area. And we really need that relationship almost as much as Israel does.
Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, the White House.
A federal court of appeals has ruled against President Obama's attempt to protect millions of people living in the U.S. illegally from deportation. The decision upholds a previous ruling by a Texas-based federal court blocking the initiative. Texas Governor Greg Abbott praised the decision, saying, quote, President Obama should abandon his lawless executive amnesty program and start enforcing the law today. Republicans have criticized the plan since the Obama administration announced it last November, and 26 states have challenged the move. Football practice resumes today at the University of Missouri now that its president has stepped down. 30 black members of the team were refusing to play in a show of support for growing calls for President Tim Wolf to resign. The head football coach also supported his players' decision to boycott. Students felt President Wolf showed indifference to racial tensions at the school. He now says he takes full responsibility for the frustration, and he said their complaints were clear and real. Investigators in Colorado and New York are working two high school sexting scandals this week and facing some difficult options. They're trying to avoid multiple felony charges and registering students as lifelong sex offenders. But as Heather Sells reports, current policy makes that a challenge.
At Cannon City High, officials have suspended an unknown number of students for exchanging hundreds of explicit photos of other students, some as young as eighth grade. And in New York, a Long Island school district has suspended dozens of students for sending or receiving sexually explicit videos.
It's impossible to believe that your son could get in trouble because somebody forwarded a video to his phone that he has no control over receiving it.
Authorities in Colorado say teens swap nude photos of each other like trading cards. They then hid them in smartphone apps designed to look like regular calculators.
Hold your fingers on it for 3 seconds. Type in the code. And now it's a hidden photo vault where you can see all my pictures I'm hiding from my parents or anyone else.
The current sexting investigations have caught students by surprise. Many in Colorado say sexting was common at Cannon City High and that few realized it's a felony on par with child pornography.
You don't really think about it until it actually comes up, you know? Like, we're young, we're stupid, we're gonna do things like that.
So much of the time, technology outpaces policy, and I think that's what we're seeing here.
Prosecutors say they'll use common sense in deciding what charges students should face. Colorado lawmakers are considering turning sexting charges into mere misdemeanors And at least one county is experimenting with a class for teens charged with sexting and their parents. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Coming up, staggering losses for Democrats in the House, the Senate, and most state governorships. The reason, one expert says, President Obama is to blame. We're going to show you why. The government debt is actually far higher than officials say it is. That is the warning from David Walker, the former head of the Government Accountability Office under Presidents Clinton and George W. Bush. The debt is officially $18 trillion, but Walker says it actually amounts to about $65 trillion when you add in unfunded government liabilities for Social Security, Medicare, civilian and military pensions, and more. The Hill reports Walker made his remarks on an AM radio show in New York called The Catch Roundtable. Walker points out that a growing national debt hurts the economy. And he says Americans have, quote, lost touch with reality when it comes to spending. Well, it is one of the most important political trends in decades, years and years of losses at the ballot box for the Democratic Party, both in Congress and at the state level across the country. And when did it start? When Senator Barack Obama became President Barack Obama. Paul Strand brings us the story now from Washington.
One almost feels sorry for the Democrats.
Political historian Lee Edwards at the Heritage Foundation says last Tuesday's Republican victories just add to the GOP gains from the 2010 Tea Party revolution and 2014's election night.
Which was a GOP tsunami. And yet, this White House and Democrats are trying to put on a happy face and say, well, you know, this is terrific, you know, we're going to look forward to what's going to happen in 2016.
Fact of the matter is, President Obama will leave his party in much worse shape than he found it. The numbers show it in stark detail.
When President Obama took office in 2009, Democrats controlled the White House and both chambers in Congress, with Nancy Pelosi as House Speaker and Harry Reid running the Senate. More than half the state's governors were Democrats, and in state legislatures, Democrats had full control in 27 states. Today, after nearly 7 years of Obama as president, Democrats have lost 13 U.S. Senate seats and 69 in the House, 12 state governors, and a whopping 910 seats in state legislatures. And now the GOP controls both the governor's mansion and both houses of the legislature in 24 states.
This president who said, I'm going to be a transformational president, well, it seems to me what he has done is to transfer the Democratic Party into a minority party. And that isn't the transformation the Democrats want.
As a student of political history, Edwards has studied U.S. presidents in depth. He says of Obama,
he's the most self-absorbed president that we've had in modern times, maybe in American history. He believes in himself so deeply that he does not listen to and look at the returns at the ballot box. Well, I'm sure Democrats from the House and the Senate are saying to him, look, can't we maybe take a second look at these issues?
But White House spokesman Josh Earnest's comments after last week's latest round of Democratic losses shows that the administration isn't backing down on its liberal positions.
Now, there have been other Democrats that have sought to run on this agenda, and they've been served well by making that decision.
But that agenda, including issues like Obamacare and gun control, failed to help Democrats in key elections last week, where Republicans kept control of the state Senate in Virginia and took the governor's mansion in Kentucky for only the second time in four decades. But Obama has stuck with his policies, no matter how much they've hurt his own party. And Edwards says there's a reason for that, the president's utter faith that he's right.
He's stuck in believing himself to be the most brilliant president, maybe since Thomas Jefferson.
Like all presidents, Barack Obama wanted a strong, positive historical legacy. But the reality is a major part of his legacy will be his own party, decimated by years of historic election losses, both here in Washington and across the country. Paul Strand, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
For more on what the president is doing in the White House and how it's impacting America, the host of CBN 700 Club, Pat Robertson, spoke with Daniel Mitchell. He's a senior fellow with the Cato Institute.
Let me give you some discouraging news. If you're Barack Obama, maybe you're willing to accept some short-term defeats for your political party if, in exchange, with things like Obamacare, you're creating more long-run dependency on government in the American population. Maybe if you're Obama, you're willing to sacrifice some short-term political gains in order to expand the power of the bureaucracy to erode the rule of law and replace your congressional legislation with just bureaucratic edicts and rules. So I'm a little bit worried that we have to actually figure out how to change these policies and curtail the power of government. Otherwise, Obama may actually be the one with the last laugh because he will have changed the culture and nature of America.
Well, let's just take the EPA, for example, Carmen rules and so forth. He's attacked the coal industry, and he wants to change the way we produce things. He's into this green revolution stuff. How lasting is that? I mean, can say there's another Congress that comes in with another president. Can they overturn that? Can they fire these people?
In theory, if there's a new president who has a better sense of what's good policy for the economy, but more importantly, also has a sense of proper limits on the executive power of the White House, that new president can tell the EPA, all right, we want to undo these policies because Congress never voted on them. You're in effect making up law instead of enforcing law. So yes, in theory, a new White House can begin to unwind some of this damage, but I'm worried that because they're facing such a hostile establishment press, a lot of Republicans will be nervous about undoing some of this damage. So Obama will have expanded the power of government. He will have eroded the rule of law. And then if Republicans take over in 2017, well, maybe they'll cut back only 10% or 20% of what Obama did. So we'll still be in a worse position than when we started.
Well, you know, the media in Washington, let's face it, it lives on government. The Washington Post has circulation. The more bureaucrats they are buying the Post, the more circulation they have. In terms of the talking heads on the various networks, if they're the Washington bureau chief, the bigger Washington is, the more important it is, the more airtime they get, so they want it bigger. And the bureaucrats want it bigger, and the real estate people in Washington want more bureaucrats, so there's kind of a inbred mafia, whatever you want to use the term, that causes this bigness to stay there.
Washington is a company town, and the company is big government. And here's the thing that really discourages me. The richest metropolitan region in the United States is now the greater Washington area because you have so many overpaid bureaucrats, so many fat cat lobbyists, so much money sloshing around that's being taken from hardworking Americans and the real economy. It's being transferred to Washington, and it's just like it's like a bunch of pigs in a pigsty rolling in mud. They're having a great time. They're living the life of Riley. They're on Easy Street because government has gotten so big, and it's really tragic when you think about the fact that a lot of companies now think their best way to make money is by getting in bed with politicians and doing corrupt deals like the Export-Import Bank or looking for subsidies or handouts. That's cronyism. That's not capitalism. And so I worry we're becoming more like France and Greece, and that's not going to be good for the American people.
And to see the full interview with Daniel Mitchell, log on to cbnnews.com. Up next, fasting is good for our spiritual lives, but new research shows it's also good for our health. We'll unpack the numbers next. Health experts are nudging Americans to kick their sugar habit. For the first time ever, the Food and Drug Administration is recommending a daily cap on the amount of sugar you eat. Health officials say to limit your added sugar to no more than 10% of your daily calories, which is the same amount of sugar found in a can of Coke. That means getting rid of high sugar items like sodas, cookies, and candies. Under the new guidelines, the amount of added sugars will be added to nutrition labels on packaged foods. Well, once again, scientists are discovering the health benefits of Bible practices. We've already told you, doctors say forgiveness, resting, and letting go of worry are good for your body. Well, now you can add fasting to that list. Lori Johnson explains.
It appears fasting dramatically strengthens our immune system. Researchers at the University of Southern California studied humans and mice who went without food for 2 to 4 days at a time for 6 months. The fasting triggered their bodies to get rid of old, inefficient cells and regenerate new, healthy ones.
This means fasting could be a key to aging well, because as we get older, our immune system weakens, making us more vulnerable to disease. Fasting could prove especially beneficial to people going through chemotherapy or who suffer from autoimmune disorders.
Fasting reduces the enzyme PKA, clearing the way for stem cells to renew, and lowers levels of the IGF-1 growth hormone, which is linked to cancer. One of the study authors compared it to lightening a plane of excess baggage, saying when you starve, the system tries to save energy, and one of the things it can do to save energy is to recycle a lot of the immune cells that are not needed, especially those that may be damaged. So what's good for our spiritual health also appears to be good for our physical health. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
It is also a good thing to fast and to give as well. Stay with us. We're coming right back. It is a tweetable Tuesday, and here is a thought for you to consider and share with others. When you fail to take full advantage of the promises of God, you are living in a museum of blessings that you aren't even touching, and that's no place for miracles. So tap into all that you have. They are seeds to be planted so that greater fruit can grow. I pray that inspires you just as it inspired me when my pastor shared those thoughts in services on Sunday. Make this a terrific Tuesday. Well, that is going to do it for this edition of CBN NewsWatch. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. And take the time to tell us what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can do that online. Hope you'll join us again right here next time. We'll see you tomorrow.